Thank you to Ariel and the band. What a great job of leading us into God's presence and leading us in worship. Especially want to thank Ariel. He's not feeling great this morning. Earlier on, he was having a rough time. He powered through, and I want to thank him for that. You know, having a brand new baby at home will do that to you, won't it? So they're so excited for them. Mom and baby are doing great, and we're going to keep them in our prayers. And after you get a little bit of time under the belt, I'm sure we'll be seeing her here very, very soon. So thank you, Ariel, for leading us. Thank you to the band for everything. I'm going to ask, even at the outset this morning, that you keep me in your prayers as well. I was supposed to play with them this morning, and I begged off this morning because I'm not feeling so great either. I'm just struggling a little bit. I spent the week in New York with a bunch of a group of pastors that I've been learning with over the past 5 years. According to my Fitbit, I logged over 58 miles walking up and down and across Manhattan and Brooklyn, and probably even more miles than that riding around in the subway. So you can know my voice is kind of struggling a little bit, so I appreciate your prayers for me. But I didn't want to miss this Sunday. I said this is an exciting Sunday as we start off our stewardship campaign. Our stewardship campaign this year the title is Count Me In. It's what we're calling this, basing it on a great passage of scripture that's probably familiar to many of you. It's at the end of the book of Joshua. Once the people have gone in and possessed the land that God had promised to Abraham and their ancestors, Joshua gathers them together in the valley of Shechem and kind of puts things before them and ends with that great line that many of you know well. Choose for yourselves this day who you will serve, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And so that's the choice that we're facing as we go into this stewardship campaign, as we think about whether or not we want to say, yes, count me in. I choose that. And so thank you for the applause anyway. I know that for most of us, for the next this week and the next 3 weeks, we'll be talking about stewardship. And I know that for many of us, that's about as exciting as a trip to the dentist.
All right, here. Okay, now let's see. You want to pull your tooth out? P. 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 U. P. U. L. P. U. L. L. Pull tooth. T. 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 O. T. O. O. T. O. T. O. T. H. Here we are. Pull your tooth out. Boy, this is going to hurt.
Doctor, if it's going to hurt, please give me something to kill the pain.
Yeah, okay, well, got some Novocaine right here. Hold on that, Mel. Let's see how this works here. Okay, Novocaine. Here we are, Novocaine. Take a firm hold of the hypodermic needle. Right. There'll be a little bit of pain, and then numbness will set in.
Well, I'm no Tim Conway, but hopefully I can make these next few weeks, as we talk about stewardship, as we talk about giving, as we talk about money, that pleasurable for you. A lot of people kind of have this feeling that I don't want to go to church, all they ever do is talk about money. Sometimes we have to talk about money, and I want to share with you kind of why that is, because what I want to do and what I want to focus in on these next few weeks of messages and some letters and other stuff that you're going to be getting at home is I'm not going to say that the church doesn't need your money, because we do, but that isn't the focus or the drive of stewardship. It shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. I can tell you this, God does not need your money. God doesn't need your money. So stewardship and giving isn't a matter of what God needs. What I want you to understand at the end of these 4 weeks is that stewardship and giving and generosity of heart and spirit and generosity with your gifts and your blessings, it's something that you need. It's something that you need. It is an important aspect of our spiritual lives. It is one of the best barometers that we have of where we truly are in our heart and in our soul, in our spirit. That's one of the things we've been doing in our deeper groups. I've been encouraging you each week to visit that question, how is it with your soul? And I've talked about how important it is to have people in our lives who can talk to us and ask us that question. And it's not just the polite, common, everyday, how are you doing, I'm doing fine, that we do, just to be polite in the world. But we need people that can ask us, how are you doing? How is your heart? How is your soul? How are you really on the inside? And they really mean that question, and they want you to answer it. And you feel comfortable and safe that you can answer that question with them completely, just to be authentic and be real and be honest with them without fear of judgment, without fear of them thinking any less of you, knowing that they love you and they have your best at heart for you, and all they want to do is encourage you. We need those kind of relationships. We need people to look into our souls. But it's easy enough to face that question and not answer it honestly. Say, oh, well, things are great. I mean, I go to church. I do. Everything's great. Well, money. What we do with our money, how we steward the gifts that God has given us in our lives, is something we can't fake. And so it is one of the most tangible, one of the most visible, one of the most obvious measures of really answering that question. How is it with your soul? So I want you to understand through these next few weeks that stewardship and giving and generosity, this is a matter of spiritual discipline. This is what it's about. This is how we grow in our hearts and in our spirit and in our faith, by attending to spiritual disciplines like giving. And so that's where we're going to focus for the next few weeks. And so as we do that, I want to begin this morning with the concept of invitation. We know how important invitation can be in our lives. It's important to be chosen. It's important to be picked. It's important to be selected. I mean, it's been important to us since our days on the playground.
Okay, let's see, four captains, Norklin, Simeone, Rygott, O'Hara. The rest of you boys stand up on the line.
But just in case there was a little fun left in basketball.
Okay, let's pick teams.
We would now be turned loose on each other.
I got Jenkins.
I got Schneider.
Picking teams. It had to be one of the most grueling rituals of childhood.
Yeah, I'll take Vogel.
But I figured it wouldn't be long now. I had myself pegged for a second, maybe a third round draft choice.
Evans. Gliwa.
Platt, I guess.
All right, any time now. Yep, I'm ready to play.
Give me Colburn, I guess.
That's right. Over here, O'Hara. Keep coming.
Give me...
That's it.
Nah, give me Wilson. Ah.
All right now, Rygott, come on, man. Don't forget those biology notes.
I'll take Arnold, I guess.
Okay. All right. Not too bad. Top half of the class. There were more than a few poor losers who were worse off than old Kevin... Did I say losers? That's harsh. good. It was down to Paul and Joey Harris. To be picked late was bad. But to be picked last?
I guess I'll take Harris. Okay, fine, I'll take Pfeiffer.
Yeah, and in case you were wondering, yes, Joey Harris was Screech. So we know what it's like to stand in the line, to be picked or not picked, to be chosen or not chosen, to be invited or not invited. And so today I want to talk about how we are all invited, and it begins since we're using the backdrop of Joshua's challenge to the people of God and therefore his challenge to you and me in the Valley of Shechem so long ago to choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Since we're using that challenge as kind of the backdrop in this stewardship campaign, I want to begin at the beginning of that story. You see, that was a culmination of a great story in Scripture. It began in the 12th chapter of the book of Genesis. We read there that the Lord had said to Abram, who will later become Abraham, the Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, and all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people that he had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Morah at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring, I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. So this is where the story that culminates in the 24th chapter of Joshua begins, with God calling out to Abram, who was from Ur of the Chaldeans, who had moved, which is at the southern end of the Tigris and Euphrates River near modern-day Iran, and he had moved all the way up to the northern end of the river in Haran, which is kind of near modern-day southern edge of Turkey. It's there that God calls out to him and tells him to leave everything behind and to come to a land that he would show him. And he finally reaches this place, this oak tree at the valley of Shechem. And he says, God tells him there, "I will give this land." And he names the boundaries of the land, says, "I will give it to your ancestors." Well, in the 24th chapter of the book of Joshua, some 500 years later, his ancestors now possess the land. And Joshua, their leader, gathers them back in Shechem, where God had told Abram, "This is the land I am promising you." He gathers them back there on the exact same spot. And he says, "Now it is your turn to choose." And all of them that day said, "Count me in." And my hope and my prayer is over the next 4 weeks, all of us will say, "Count me in" as well. So as we look at this story of invitation, and we look at this story of Abram being chosen and selected by God, and his descendants being chosen and selected by God, I want to kind of take it apart and kind of walk through this scripture, this wonderful passage of scripture that is foundational to our understanding of the Christian faith. I've shared it with you before. Paul is very, very clear that what God was doing in Jesus was adopting us into this family tree of Abraham. He was grafting us into this family tree. That those are two metaphors, two images that Paul uses to help us understand that as disciples of Jesus, as followers of Jesus, we are inheritors of this promise that God makes to Abraham and his ancestors. We are now his ancestors as well through Jesus. So I want to look at this promise and kind of come to understand it just a little bit better. And this invitation that God, this promise that God gives to Abram, comes with, it's a both and. It comes with some things that Abram has to leave behind, and it comes with some promises of what he will receive. So I want to look at what Abram was called to leave. The first thing that God tells Abram to do is to go from your country. So Abram was called to leave his country. That is his identity, his who he was. It kind of defines who you are, your country. Who are those people who are there for you? Who are those people who are like you? Who are those people that you know best and that you can relate to most easily? God tells Abram to leave all of these things behind, the familiar faces, the familiar people, the people who are like him, the people who look like him, who have values like him, who think like he does. And God says to Abram, I want you to leave all of that. Leave it behind. Think about that. The things that are comfortable in life, the things that make us feel comfortable, the things that are familiar to us, the things that we know, the things that we are accustomed to, these are the things that God tells Abram to leave behind. He gets a little bit narrower in scope with his next invitation. He tells him not only to leave your country, but leave your people. Leave your people behind. Now, this is a much tighter network. These are the people that Abram knows and associates with, people that he has relationships with, people that he has built a life with. It's his opportunity to know and to be known. These are people that he has invested life and time with. And God tells him to leave all of that behind. And then finally, something that I think we don't fully understand because it's the cultural gaps and the cultural differences between our day and time and that day and time are so wide and so varied. But the final thing that God tells Abram to leave behind is to leave behind your father's household. Your father's household. I want you to understand that this household would have been, it was the fundamental, the foundational building block of life for people in this culture and in this world and in this time. It would consist of multiple generations of the same family. So it was a wide, extended family. And then people that they had taken under their wings, people that maybe were in their employ, people that were watched over by them, that they had invited into their households as well. So leaving your father's household behind, what God is telling Abraham to do is leave behind really every safety net that he has in his life. These are the people that when push comes to shove, they would fight for him. They would be there for him no matter what. You know, when we went through Harvey, we had a lot of strangers come and help us, but the first people that were there were people that knew us and loved us and cared about us. That's who his household is. And God tells Abram to leave that behind. This is a tremendous ask that God is placing on Abram. Leave behind your country where comfortable, where people are like you, where there's some shared values going on, where maybe you have some business relationships, where you're comfortable and you feel at home. Leave behind your people. That is those folks that are closer to you and people that you actually know and have built and developed relationships with. And then your household, your father's household, those people who are there for you for thick and thin. And what all these represent for Abraham is security. This was his security. This was your security in life was based on these kinds of connections. If you were here last week and I talked about some women who Jesus crossed paths and they had lost a widow who had lost her son, Mary and Martha who had lost their brother, these people who had lost the men in their life who were their connections to a father's household. And Jesus recognized what a perilous position that put them in. They had no more security, and so he supplied them. He raised Lazarus from the dead and gave him back to his sisters, Mary and Martha. He raised this son and gave him back to this widow from the town of Nain. I think it's amazing that Jesus raises three people from the dead in Scripture, and all three of them were these family relationships, were these kinds of relationships, these household relationships, the people that you need and that you count on and that you look to. And this is your security in life. And God tells Abram to leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Think about this. Up to this point, Abram, like everyone else in the world he lived in, believed in the supernatural, believed in the divine, believed not that there was a God, but that there were many gods. And that each group, each tribe of people, each group of people had their own personal gods that looked out for them and defended them and took care of them. There was not this concept of there being one supreme God who is above all and over all. And so from out of nowhere, a voice speaks to him. Doesn't tell him really who it is. Doesn't say to him, I am the God who created everything. Doesn't say to him, I am the one and only true God. Just says to him, leave every fiber of security that is in your life behind. Leave it all behind. And catch this. And go to a place that I will show you. Does that sound like a scam or what? Give me your bank account. Give me your routing numbers and your checking account number, and I will send you some money. Right? I mean, it's really, leave everything that gives you security and life behind and go to a place that I will show you. Doesn't even tell him where it is. Miraculously, Abram says yes. And centuries later, Paul would write in the New Testament, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. As righteousness. This tremendous act of faith that Abram did. To say yes to this strange voice from out of nowhere telling him to leave behind everything that gave him security in life and not giving him any details as to where he would go. There are a few things that God outlines that Abram will receive if he says, count me in. I am part of this. What does Abram receive? The first thing that Abram is promised is that I will make of you a great nation. I will make of you a great nation. That is, I will give you a new people. I will give you a new people to call your own. People that you can relate to, people that you can connect with. I will give you a new nation. I will make out of you a great nation. And the second thing that God promises him is I will give you a great name. I will give you a great name. You see, in leaving behind all of his people, that's what Abram was leaving behind. He was leaving behind people that he had a name with them, who knew him, who knew what kind of man he was. He could do business with them because they knew that he was honorable, that he would do what he said. They knew his character. He had a name among these people. That's the most difficult thing about going off on your own to a place that you've never been, where no one knows you from Adam. God says they will know you. They will know you, and they will know who you are, and you will have a great name among them. And then God says an amazing thing, and those who bless you, I will bless. And those who curse you, I will curse. Those who bless you, I will bless. Those who curse you, I will curse. In other words, God says to Abram, I got your back. I got your back. If anyone comes after you, I will protect you. If anyone is there to bless you, I will bless them in return. I will take care of you. And what all this represents to Abram as he's hearing God lay out all these things, this is hope. This is hope and a promise. That's what he's got. That's what he's got in front of him. And Abram is asked to leave behind all of his security, everything he knows, everyone he knows, for hope and a promise. For hope and a promise. And get this, once he gets there to Shechem and God shows him the land, what does God say to him? To your offspring, I will give this land. Abram doesn't even get it himself. It's not for him. It's for his offspring. Think about this, though. He was 75 years old and had no children. And God said, I will give all of this to your offspring. To your offspring. And Abram believed God. And it was credited to him as righteousness. So what Abram was faced with in this invitation that is extended to you and me through him, what he was faced with was to leave behind everything that his culture and his world and his society and his experiences told him accounted for security in life. All these things that make you safe and secure in life, being part of a nation, having people that are there for you, having a household that will protect you no matter what. He was told to leave all of that behind. But look at how these things line up real quick. Now, the things that Abram was asked to leave behind, he was asked to leave his country behind. But what was he promised? A great nation. A great nation. Leave your country behind. I will give you a great nation. I will give you an even better country and nation to be your people. Leave your people behind, and I will make sure that where you go, you will have a great name. People will know you and will respect you and will know who you are and will be there for you. Blessing and cursing, protection. Leave your father's household behind. That is those you could count on to protect you and to have your back. And I will have your back in their place. You see, there's a perfect match between what God tells Abram to leave behind and what God promises to give him in return. Leave the security that you see in the world, and I will give you this hope and this promise. You don't need God in your life. Plenty of people go through life without a thought for God and the things of God. They live their lives. They feel fulfilled. They feel happy. Not all of them, but then not all people of faith are always happy and fulfilled either, right? So there are people who manage to live this life and be okay. They have security without God in their life. What God says to Abram and what God says to you and me and what God says to everyone, what Jesus promised, you won't just have life. You have abundant life. Can you live your life without God? Yes. Can you live your best life without him? Absolutely not. The best, the most fulfilling, the most rewarding, the most meaningful, the most significant life you will ever live is a life that you live following God. That really was the choice that Abram faced. Content yourself with what the world tells you you need to be safe and secure. Or trust me that I will take even better care of you. That's what we face. So the question for you and me is, where do we find our security? What do we look for security? And let's not kid ourselves. We live in a capitalistic, consumeristic society and nation. Security in 2018 in the United States of America and in most of the world is money. That's how we feel safe and secure, when there's money in the bank account. When I know if there's an accident and something happens, I have what I need to take care of it. When do we not feel safe and secure? When we're living paycheck to paycheck. And we know all it takes is you know, one accident, a trip to the emergency room, the car breaks down, the air conditioner goes out, the roof starts to leak. And we know we don't have the resources to deal with that. And when you're there, you don't feel safe. You don't feel secure. So money is one of the most significant markers of security in our culture and in our society. They mean to us many of the same things that nation and people and father's household meant to Abram. And God says, I have so much more to give you. I have so much more to give you. But you've got to let go of this security from these things and trust me. And trust me. I shared with you that I spent the week in New York. One of the places that we went to learn from was really an amazing experience. We went to Google's headquarters in New York. A lot of wonderful things we learned from them about creativity and innovation and those kinds of things. And one of the neat lessons that I learned there, they talked to us about the imposter syndrome. Imposter syndrome. See, Google has an amazing workforce. It's very hard to get on with Google. And they have very little turnover. They lose only about 4% of their employees from year to year. And almost all of them are lost because they go off on their own business ventures. They don't leave Google because they're not happy. They don't leave Google because someone gives them a better offer. They leave because they have an idea that they want to start their own business. It is an amazing place to be and to work. They did an internal study and found out that some 75% of their employees suffered from imposter syndrome. And what that is that feeling of, I don't belong here. I don't know how I slipped through the cracks and managed to land this job, but I don't belong here. I'm surrounded by all these other geniuses, all these other amazing people. I don't know how I got here. I don't belong here. Many of us suffer with that in the spiritual life. I do from time to time. I really do. I love an old Rich Mullins song. I'm a good Midwestern boy. I'd give an honest day's work if I could get them. I'd cheat on my taxes. I'd cheat on my girl. I've got values that can make the White House jealous. That meant a little bit more several decades ago when he wrote it. He goes on to say, but I still get a little bit overimpressed until I think of Peter and Paul and the apostles. I don't stack up too well against them, I guess. But by the standards around here, I'm not doing that. That old poem, Desiderata, you know, be careful comparing yourselves to others because there are always greater and lesser persons than yourselves. All it takes is some of those greater persons to come along, and we begin feeling, maybe I don't have faith. Maybe I don't trust. I don't. Because so much of the life of the Spirit and the life of faith is internal, is intangible. You can't put your hands on it. Just know what you know. You feel what you feel, right? That's why what we do with our money is so important. Because that's something you can see. That's something you can touch. That's something you can feel. I trust God take care of me, to provide for me, to give me a rich and abundant and fulfilling life? Or do I trust myself and my own resources, and what I can earn, and what's in my bank account? Through these next few weeks, I hope that we can learn to put our trust in God. Go of some of those things that we feel like give us security in this life. As an act of faith, as an act of trust, say, yes, I believe God. I trust you. You are always good. Amen.